drowning her.
What's wrong?
Why would you break her? Kelsey, did you break my chair?
You guys, there's just a stick of wood over here. What's happening?
Did you break my chair?
I did not break it, no.
Who broke it?
I don't know.
You had to buy me a chair. That's vintage.
Okay.
Yes. Matchmaker, matchmaker, make me a match. What's that from?
Find me a find.
Catch me a catch. Hi guys.
Hi Jenna. How are
you? We're back.
Yeah.
What?
We're both doing the little.
Bless you. She started. I'll go on this side.
You don't want to match me?
No.
That's fine, I guess.
Matchmaker, matchmaker, make me a match. What's that from?
Find me a find. Catch me a catch.
Okay. What's it from? I think it's from Fiddler on the Roof, but I've never seen that. I don't know why.
I think that's from a contemporary movie.
Fiddler on the Roof.
Thank you.
Musical.
I've never even seen it.
I've never seen that movie.
How do we know that song?
Musical. Sorry. Is it a play?
It's a musical.
But there's a movie that quotes it.
There's a movie musical.
No. I'm saying there's a movie that quotes that saying.
Probably. What
I
is it?
I think it's Mrs. Doubtfire.
Oh, it is. That's why I know it too. Man, that's a good movie.
Thank you for letting the Holy Spirit work through you. And thank you for your journaling advice last week.
Oh, praise God. Yeah.
Guys, I didn't hear it because I was feeding the baby. And my phone is this device right here. So I think it was beautiful. Thank you, Beth, for your wisdom today.
Yeah, you're so welcome. We talked about it before I did it, so it's fine. You know.
Yeah.
You know. I felt a little silly. I couldn't remember the mysteries I prayed last night.
Were you supposed
to
talk about?
Took me a minute. Well, I wanted to talk about this moment, this like revelation I had praying, finding the child Jesus in the temple.
Oh, that's called the joyful mystery.
I couldn't remember. I was like, it's one of the mysteries. It's the fifth? I think it's the last one.
It is.
Joyful! If I would have just thought yesterday was Monday. I pray them on an app, so I like pray the mysteries of the day.
Do you use one journal for everything? Scripture, reflections, personal feelings.
Yeah. Are we making a journaling vid?
Yeah, we talked about it. Habit stacking. Always reach for my phone when I wake up to turn off my alarm and now read the daily readings instead of checking my notifications.
You know, one of my gal pals in the well told me as soon as she wakes up and turns off her alarm, she makes the sign of the cross.
Wow.
I was like, that's like the easiest habit to stack.
My bestie and I started the BIS prayer pledge in January and decided to pray a chapter of scripture a day.
Yeah.
Her accountability has helped my prayer schedule so much. Plus 7 months of scripture, life-changing.
Yeah.
Totally.
That's so good. Accountability is huge. That would have been a good fourth tip today. Can't win them all. Yeah.
Do you want to answer if you have the same journal for everything? Did you?
Yeah, I do. I put everything in there. Sometimes I draw. Yeah, like if I have an image and I want to remember it, I'll just kind of draw. Or if I like want to pray into that image, I'll kind of sketch it out. And let me tell you something. I am not an artist. Pretty humble situation.
My alarm says you are a beloved daughter of the Most High King to start my day off instead of social media. How does your alarm say that? You like talked into it?
You.
Tell me everything, Cassie.
Of the Most High King.
Why does it sound like
that? Well, I don't know, like that robotic voice that's like.
Is that what Siri sounds
yeah,
like?
Yeah, when Siri like reads something, she would read
she
this.
She doesn't say that.
My alarm says, you are a beloved daughter of the Most High King.
You can label your alarm, it says.
Oh, yeah, yes. Mine says his mercies are new every morning.
You can type in a label.
Yeah, you just label it, but it doesn't say it to you, right?
That'd be cool if you could record
yourself?
Someone saying it.
And like record a ringtone?
Yeah.
That'd be cool.
And the ringtone said, you are the daughter of the Most High King. You are the daughter of the Most High King. You are the daughter of the Most High King.
That would get me out of bed.
Are the white church candles you can buy blessed?
They're not. You actually can't buy blessed items. So you gotta get them blessed.
Some people asked if we could bless the planners. We can't do that.
We cannot bless.
We did that once. You wanna tell the story, Beth?
Then we got in trouble. I feel like we just told it. That was the story. We were like, it would be so sweet to like bless these because we want to like bless the women.
Yeah.
And then people were.
Yeah, that's not allowed.
People were pretty angry in the DMs. And we were like, oh! Then we were like, Father, what do we do? Can we still sell them? He's like, it's fine.
But why were they angry?
Because they had to buy them and they were blessed. But we weren't like saying, buy your blessed whatever. We were just like saying we love these women.
You're not allowed to buy a blessing, basically.
That's it.
You're buying a product. But you can't buy a blessing. You know what I mean, guys?
No, you
Anyone?
Can't.
If you have a full day, is formula prayer enough? Or do you recommend meditation contemplative prayer?
Yes. I think formulaic prayer, like devotions.
Like rote prayers?
Yeah, that's like good scaffolding, right? But it's always meant to lead to meditation or contemplation. Totally. It's always meant...
The catechism says.
Yeah, to lead to relationship, to intimacy, to conversational prayer. If you have these rote prayers, like, throughout your day, like, I have an alarm on my phone for the Angelus every day at noon. When that alarm goes off, I'm reminded, oh, I was, like, doing my own thing. Now I'm turning my eyes back to the Lord. And that anchors me now in relationship. And it's easier then to continue conversationally with the Lord. It's not like, oh, I prayed the Angelus, I'm done praying today. Rote prayer is prayer, and it's also support to deeper prayer.
I'm beginning prayer again today for since a long time. Tips for what I should do to start again.
I would just start in silence.
Every time I go to spiritual direction, my spiritual director is like, I'm always like right into prayer. Yeah. And he's like, let's become aware of the presence of God. And I'm like, oh, let's. Thought we were, okay. And then I'm like, oh, quiet for a while. And I'm like peeking out.
Yeah.
Then he's like, in the name of the Father. Like, the point of any rote prayer is that we're connecting with a live, living person. There, Shay, you guys. What a gem.
That's amazing.
He is amazing.
I love that. Yeah, so I think that's a good place to begin again every day.
Yeah. Just take a deep breath. Be quiet.
Totally. What does he say? Become aware of the presence?
Yeah, that's an Ignatian. That's how you would start the examine every day. That's the first step of the examine is to become aware of the presence of God.
That Ignatius. He knew so what just he was like talking stop, about.
All that means, that's like fancy language. You know, don't overcomplicate it. But that's just saying, oh, I'm remembering God is already here. He's with me. He loves me. He's already looking at me. And I'm just reminding myself that he's here.
Okay.
That's what it means to become aware of the presence of God.
Starting again in prayer, remember Acts.
Adoration, confession, thanksgiving, supplication.
We have a whole download on our website of that. I forgot.
Yeah.
That was like a prayer pledge from a few years ago. Do you think it's enough to pray one rosary a day, or must you say a full rosary of all 20 mysteries daily?
Oh my goodness. Do you do that?
A full, wait, what?
Unbelievable.
A full rosary.
So like religious sisters would pray a full rosary, which is all of the mysteries. So four
which
rosaries.
Is just one time around. That's a full rosary for me. Yes, I think it's enough to pray anytime.
I think it's enough to pray a decade.
I think it's enough to pray for 5 minutes.
It's whatever the Lord is asking of you, you know? But if it's your, I kind of alluded to this a bit in Teachable Tuesday. I try not to make things my idea, especially when it comes to prayer. So I could be doing a full rosary. I could be doing all four mysteries. But if God's not asking me to do that, if there's not grace to do that, if that doesn't match with my season in life, it's not going to be effective. It's going to be works. It's going to be like empty works. But if the Lord is like, pray a full rosary. I want you to be close to my mother. I want you to meditate. You're in this season. There's grace there to do that. I just try not to
And it gives you life. It doesn't feel like bogged down.
Yes.
Totally. Or like an obligation.
I was just thinking, I can be kind of lenient on myself if I'm like, I'm not really feeling this. Maybe it's not the season. Ultimately, that's why I asked the Lord when he was like, go back to daily mass. I said, when? How many days? Like every day? So I just ask for clarification because I want to go where the grace is.
Yeah.
I don't want to. I think this is a mistake that people make when they're trying to establish a prayer routine is, oh, I heard a talk on this one time and I really need to do this and I should be doing this. And then we bite off more than we can chew. We get overwhelmed. Then we're discouraged. Then we give up prayer entirely. But instead, if you just ask the Lord, how do you want me to pray today? And then do that. There's grace there. It will be a joy. There will be good fruit from prayer instead of, you know, you could pray a full rosary. I'm just using that as an example, but you could pray a full rosary, but never feel connected to the Lord, not feel renewed, just feel like, oh.
Yeah, my spiritual director said to me, like, have your dedicated time of prayer and do what you feel called to pray. Mm-hmm. So she didn't tell me this is the way you should pray. She said, what do you feel closest to the Lord? What kind of prayer?
Mm.
So for me, it was reading scripture. So went from there. And I set prayer time. That was what I did and have been doing every day.
That's what works for you.
Totally.
You enjoy it. You feel connected to the Lord when you do it.
Thought that was good wisdom.
What are you reading right now? We just finished reading 2 Corinthians together.
Well, I'm reading what she told me to read. It was a feeling like a burden, not a joy.
Yeah. You can just let it go, you know, in peace. Like, oh, it wasn't the... That's a nice...
Yeah, you don't have to feel guilty either.
It's like a beautiful idea. That's a beautiful devotion.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean you're called to it today. Might come back around.
Lucia said the beach connects me to God.
Me too, Lucia.
It's the greatest me place ever. Too. I'm obsessed with it.
Yeah.
When did each of you start with spiritual direction and why did you choose to start?
I
and
started,
how do you find one?
I started spiritual direction...
A long time ago.
Yeah, like... probably more than 10 years ago.
Why? What prompted you to start?
I mean, I was in full-time ministry.
Yeah.
I really do desire to be obedient, and I don't want to be doing things on my own. I don't think I'm holy enough or mature enough or wise enough to figure out what's good for me. I want to submit my life to an authority and say, like, what do you see here that I'm missing? Where are my blind spots? And they help me to pray, to know myself, because I could go off in all kinds of crazy ways.
Yeah.
You know, scrupulosity or leniency, I could go a lot of different ways. So it was just a matter of like having someone to walk with. The first person I met with was a woman, and I met with her for years. And she was in a religious community, had made promises to that community, and I just met with her in like their missionary house. And she preferred the term spiritual companion. She's like, I'm not a priest, I'm not a spiritual director, but this is like a very wise woman in the spiritual life. After that, I had a series of priests, I had another lay woman. I could say so many things about spiritual direction. It doesn't have to be for life, but as a person who's in full-time ministry, it's important that I'm growing. It's important that I have accountability. It's important that I have someone more mature and further along in the spiritual life than me guiding me. How to find a spiritual director? I would begin by praying for a spiritual director. Like, God, if this is what I need, if this would be beneficial, I'm open to that. I want that even. And then I would just ask around. I would ask your parish priest, do you have any recommendations for a spiritual director? It's always best not to put them on the spot. Like, do you do spiritual direction?
Yeah.
Because if he has a charism for it, and if he has time for it, and if he's open to the Holy Spirit and feels called, he'll say, I could meet with you.
Yeah.
So I think it's nice to just offer, like, you know, to phrase it in terms of like an invitation. It doesn't have to be a priest. It could just be like an older, it could just be a mentor. It could be like a mom whose kids are grown and out of the house, and you have young kids, and so you want to be mentored by someone who's like a step ahead.
How do we become messengers of the word in quarantine? I'm not seeing people who aren't Catholic, so I can't spread the word much. Ideas?
I know, I've been thinking about that too. This is not a cop-out, but I think always we could be praying and interceding for people who don't know the Lord. You probably know people in your own life who are away from the church or have no faith. I would begin very intentionally interceding for them. For me, the rosary is like my home of intercession. You know, I'm just praying it, and I'm like allowing the Lord to bring people to mind, and then I'm offering people to him. I would say be devoted to the word, like be in it yourself, and it will just naturally come out of your mouth. That's been my experience with the word. I start to think in scripture and talk in scripture. It's my lens for the world. I think just share your faith, you know, like whether that's on social media or like in a text message, just to say like, oh, I went to adoration today, or I'm going to confession tomorrow. You know, to people that, I don't know, people that you wouldn't normally mention that to, you know, just to begin to talk about it like it's an important part of your life.
Yeah, I think that's a good point to think about. Who are the people in your life that you can talk about the Lord with? Even if they know the Lord, we still need to be talking about him and continue to go deeper with him and continue to talk about what's going on in prayer and pray with each other. So if that's your best friend, if that's your cousin, if that's your aunt, someone you can call and say, hey, I was thinking about you and praying for you. How are you doing?
Yeah.
That's talking about the Lord. Ultimately, you're going to invite the Lord into your relationship with each other, and that ripples out into everything. But I think the main place to start is to just start in our own prayer. Like, he has a lot to talk to us about. He has a lot to work on with us. He has a lot to reveal to us. And in that, he'll reveal people, he'll reveal situations. That's where I think it starts. Are we both cradle Catholics, or are we converts?
Both cradle Catholics. Both had a conversion of heart in high school, separately.
Yes. Evelyn said, this is going to sound funny, but I put sticky notes of scripture on signposts around my neighborhood. I don't know if it's illegal, but I went for it.
It's not illegal.
It's amazing.
I'm like, why didn't I think of that?
I love that.
Wow.
That's beautiful.
People so need to be encouraged, you know?
When you have VBS and you don't get one thing, right? Like you don't get a takeaway.
Okay.
How do you turn that reading into a prayer?
Again, I would code switch here, prayer with relationship or prayer with conversation. So when I'm not getting something out of scripture, I say to the Lord, I'm not getting anything out of this, Lord. This feels really dry. I was actually, and when I started to talk to him, I'm like, I actually didn't really like that. Like, That's very confusing. Why is this so hard? I don't know. I just start talking to him about whatever. That's how I turn it into a prayer.
And then that is prayer. I also think you can continue reading. Like, you don't have to stop at that chapter ending. You can keep reading until something touches you. You can stop reading if the first verse touches you.
Oh my gosh. I started a new book of the Bible last night, again, because we finished 2 Corinthians.
Well, I wasn't invited to this one.
Well, I was going to invite you today, Beth, because I only got one paragraph in. And it because was so good. Was so overwhelmed.
What is it? I'm on the edge of my seat.
I started reading Genesis.
No, I'm not going to read Genesis.
Why? Please? Do you want to read it with me? I just find in prayer the Lord often like brings up latter things that happen in Genesis. He'll like give me a chapter and I'm like, oh wow. You know,
I can try it.
My man Joseph is Genesis. Anyway, I'm just going to take my time. It's like...
Hey, and for confession, do you give chapters. Context to your confession, your sins, or do you just say them?
No, I usually just say them.
Yeah. That's how I feel reading Ephesians, taking me so long to get through it because I'm just marinating in the word. Kelsey said Genesis changed her life.
Yeah.
Can try it.
It's amazing. It's amazing.
Look, Jessica's confused. This is my life, Jessica, when I try to open Genesis.
You guys, listen, I'm going to tell you this. Last night I'm reading literally 5 verses. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Okay, I have chills already. So that's 2 verses. Then God said, let there be light, and there was light. Okay, I'm going to pause. I have so many things to say just about these 3 verses.
One is,
nothing has even happened yet, and the Holy Spirit was moving.
Yeah.
Like, what? The wind was moving over the water, but there was no result yet. Light hadn't come yet. Creation hadn't happened yet, but the Holy Spirit was on the move. And I was like, this is what's happening right now. We cannot see, but the Holy Spirit is moving. Like, literally, I have chills from head to toe. We don't always see what he's doing. That doesn't mean he's not doing it. 2 verses. Also, then he's like, let there be light. There was light. That he just has to say it. That's it. He has to think of it, say it.
Kelsey said I should listen to the Gathering Place podcast called A Blooming Heart, and I would be sold on Genesis.
I mean, he would also take 5 million years to get through Genesis chapters 1-3.
Who, Father Burns?
Father Burns, yeah. But can you even believe that? The Lord is on the move. Nothing had happened yet. But he was like, the Spirit was moving.
Caprice wants to start RCIA, but she's nervous. I think because there's so much I don't know, she said. Oh, I don't know anything, friend. A lot, I should say.
I
know
stuff. I just keep telling people. I don't know everything. I don't.
And you don't have to know everything.
Yes. The point is not knowing everything. That is not the point. There's no level at which you arrive and now you're ready to be Catholic or now you've earned Catholicism. No. We'll never be able to know everything.
Yeah.
This side of heaven. Don't let that stop you. The point is relationship.
He's excited for you.
I'm excited for you too.
What's your confirmation, St. Beth?
Just a sore spot.
Oh no.
Here's the thing. I feel like my mom has like 2 best friend saints, but neither of them appealed to me.
Okay.
I didn't grow up like loving saints or knowing a lot about saints. And so then I like picked a saint that I was like, yeah, he makes sense for like this particular thing. So I chose Saint Peregrine, who's the patron saint of cancer patients. My sponsor's husband had died of cancer and my mom's dad had died of cancer and I'd never met him. So I'm just like annoyed.
Why?
That because I don't have like it's like I picked him for other people.
I see.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Now I have like so many best friend saints. In fact, I was going to talk about that before you and I talked today.
Yeah.
I was thinking I was going to talk about the saints on Teachable Tuesday today because they're like some of my best friends, you know?
Someone just said they needed a friend.
Oh, the saints are the best friends.
She needs a friend.
And like I was thinking, I went to Mass this morning at St. Timothy's in Mesa and they have this like beautiful mural of like the communion of saints. And I'll just sometimes like let my attention be drawn to one or the other and I'll ask them to pray for me. And like my heart is so full and warmed by their presence. And like I could seriously cry about it. I love the saints. They've been so faithful to me. They make holiness seem possible. They make me feel like I'm not alone because I'm not. You know, we have all of heaven like on our side, you know? You're literally never alone. You have patron saints. You have a guardian angel. You have the Blessed Mother. You have Jesus. The Father is always looking at you. The Holy Spirit lives on the inside of you. You are never alone. And I know that the spiritual life can feel so lonely at times. That's the moment. Like, we need the saints, you know? We need to know, first of all, they experience loneliness, rejection, poverty, desolation. They've been through it all, and now they have that eternal perspective. They're in the kingdom. They can see what's really happening, and they can intercede to bring about God's will in our lives. Their friendship has been a massive consolation in my life. Why am I talking about this?
Confirmation saint.
Oh, yeah. So now I'm like, oh, I wish I would have picked so-and-so. I get like new patrons. It used to be every year, but now yeah. I just...
Now they just float.
Now they just kind of come in when they have something to say.
Hi guys, Jenna Gizar here. I just want to say thank you so much for coming over to our YouTube channel, hitting that subscribe button, liking this video so we can continue to create content that brings you life and happiness and laughter and gives God all the glory. We love you. We'll see you next time. Bye.